Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, and good morning. The Honorable Dean of Faculty of Visual Arts, Institut Seni Indonesia, Yogyakarta, along with the Vice Deans, the Honorable Presenters and Moderator, and outstanding invited guests, students from University Teknologi Mara, Malaysia, and distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Guest Lecture Series and International Art Exhibition, Survivability and the Arts. My name is Dara. I feel honored to be your master of ceremony for today. It is such a great pleasure to be able to be here with peers and guests at Gedung Ajiasa Faculty of Visual Arts and to greet all of the participants who joined through Zoom. I hope everyone is healthy and well. Ladies and gentlemen, before we begin our activity for today, let me read the items of our program. First, there will be a lecture from Dr. Wan Samiati Andriana Wan Muhammad Daud, continued with a lecture from Dr. Swastiwi Mdes. And in each lecture, there will be a presentation session followed by a session for discussion. Before we start, I would like to remind everyone in the building to keep your masks on at all times and be mindful of the health protocol. Now, without further ado, let's begin the first lecture of the day, The Resilience and Sustainability of Malaysian Art Execution by Dr. Wan Samiati Andriana Wan Muhammad Daud. I will give the floor to the moderator. Please welcome Mr. Octavianus Cahyono Prianto.
Okay. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, fellow academicians, honorable deans, lecturers, and students from both countries. Welcome to the second days of our lecture series. Okay. As mentioned, my name is Octavianus Cahyono Prianto. I will be the moderator for today. It's a honor to be here. And in the next few hours, I will guide the delivery and the discussion. Okay, as mentioned before, that today we will have two lectures by two prominent lecturers from two countries to highlight some of the interesting topics. The first one, will be Dr. Wan Samiati Andriana Wan Muhammad Daud, who will present the resilience and sustainability of Malaysian art execution. Okay, before we start, I will inform you the term and condition for the lecture. Okay, the time for delivery will be 30 minutes and followed by the discussion for about 40 minutes, more or less. But we have plenty of time, of course. So it will be flexible. Yeah, if the lecture is not finished yet, I think we can extend it. Or if it's finished already, we can switch to the question and answer session. Okay. And here we have already on the screen Dr. Wan Samiati. Hello. Good morning. Huh? Oh, my mic is off. Do I need to switch on here?
Okay. Assalamualaikum. Can everybody hear me?
Dr. Wan Samiati.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Hi.
Hi.
Good morning. How are you?
Yeah, I'm fine. Thank you.
Okay. Let me give you some introduction of Dr. Wan Samiati. Dr. Wan Samiati is an educator at the Faculty of Art and Design, University Technology, Marlai Malaysia. And she will present a lecture on the resilience and sustainability of Malaysian art exhibition. She wrote a lot of articles in the past, mostly an axiological study on Islamic visual art in Malaysia. And also is this sorry, we have technical problem here because my brain stopped working.
It's okay.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, that's all that we can find from the articles. I'm sorry that we cannot find more about Dr. Wan because our agent couldn't find more help for him.
It's okay.
Okay, without further ado, I would like to let Dr. Wan to present your material. Please, the screen is yours.
Okay, thank you to Mr. Octavius. And first of all, I would like to thanks to the Dean, Dr. Tambul Rahaiju, the Dean of the Faculty, and also a special thanks to Dr. Yul Riawana to invite me in this session. Okay, maybe I can share my slide here. Can I share my slide? Okay, thank you for all the participants, my student, and also the student from the faculties, Seni Rupa, Yogyakarta. Actually, I supposed to be there. Dr. Yul invited me personally, but unfortunately, there's something problem with that. I'm going to come maybe later on. I still cannot share. Can the host, let me, perhaps can the host help me to share my slide? This is, maybe you can disable my, because I cannot share my slide.
Screen sharing, dia mau screen sharing tapi nggak bisa. Dia di apa, enable dulu.
Ya, di enable dulu. I'm be honored to be a speaker. Usually in back in UITM, I usually be the moderator for all the session held in the webinar series. But it's the honor for me to be here as a speaker. And thank you very much. Okay, I can share my slide. Okay, can everybody see my slide?
Yes.
Yes, okay. My name is Wan Samiati Andriana. Actually, my mother is from Indonesia. She's in Sunda, Bandung. So I'm quite familiar with Indonesian language. So it's okay if there's a question in the air, a question and to answer is going to be in Bahasa Indonesia, I still can answer it in Bahasa, in both language, okay? So my title today is The Resilience and Sustainability of Malaysian Art Education. It's actually towards more on the UITM itself, okay? Since I'm also, I have two positions. One is as a coordinator program by research in Faculty of Fine Design, and also I've been teaching fine art in the faculty in the Department of Fine Art. Okay, so I look myself in terms of two positions, one as the staff admin and also as a lecturer in the faculty. Okay, as we know, we identify artwork in the form of sense because we find them aesthetically present, and we find that they enhance our principle of world towards of around us toward the apps using the image. So with that, it's actually arts talk about beauty and aesthetic So it's a need, it's a life, okay? So my content is actually, you can have a look, it's quite heavy, but actually my slide is full of pictures. Don't worry, you can have, I'm going to show it, especially in terms of activities, what we did in UITM, around the activity we did in UITM, since I think we have quite a similar, because everything is online, so it's have no problem with that, okay? So when I look at the title that been given the team from the presenter, so I look at my position as both as the admin staff and also as a lecturer. So with this, I come up with the two objectives. One is how the value in educator to dealing in the difficult time of COVID. Okay, this value is actually not a number. It's not talking about numbers or figure. It's actually talking about aesthetic. In terms of a philosophical world, it's called is as axology. So it's actually a value. How in terms of spiritual need. Okay, so how we are dealing with our value in terms of this decision and practical in education, and also with that. The significance is how the art education is actually and it relationship between art reforce. Okay, so with knowing this value, actually we can help establish and maintaining the involvement of art partnership. Okay, just a briefing about COVID in Malaysia is actually when is being affected in Malaysia, everything being closed, the school, the university, the system, economy, everything being closed, and we are staying at home, blurring without knowing what to do. So, and the same time as the in the as a lecturer, me myself, I mean, try to develop what is shifting we are going to do in term of this COVID session. So with that, we Malaysian have been showing the increased turn of COVID in Malaysia. Every day is going to be quite a number of dead, and so and until now it's also still quite a number of people are being affected with this kind of situation. But this we need to be we need to survive, we need to have a life, we need to sustain our life. So with that, there are quite a number of adjusting and to find the alternative in academic activity. So the first MCO we held in Malaysia, all the semester have been postponed and closed. Then, and some of it in April, they are trying to open up back in terms of teaching and learning. And again, they have been postponed back because of the increasing of COVID. Then since that, we are trying to solve what we are going to teach alternative in local. So the one thing that been introduced is the blended learning. So during the pre-COVID-19, local Malaysian, especially university, have been learning, especially the lecturer, have been teaching student with the learning blended learning, which come with the online. Okay, even though we are face to face, but we are lack of movement. We are lack of something like the need is just a surface, but without the need of teaching is going to be very difficult in terms of learning blended learning. And the for the information, actually lecturer have to learn about the online platform that we are going to use. We are going to learn about the use of Zoom, we are going to have to learn about the other platform, Google Classroom and so on. So it's actually quite a hassle also for lecturers. So because students are actually waiting for us to be to teach them. So this is actually a paper made by one of the lecturer in the UPM, which they done a survey among their students in UPM, which platform is actually quite usable to be used in the system of learning. Most of it is not is a very clear that actually Google Meet is being used.
Recording in progress.
Google Meet has been used very significantly, and our site in UiTM also, we are using Google Meet most of our class, and also we are using WhatsApp. WhatsApp is easier since we have a quite number of students and we are putting in group, so to give information using WhatsApp. So actually these two platform is quite popular in terms of using in UiTM as well as UPM. Okay. Second, myself in the position of postgraduate, we are using most of it is WebEx. Since WebEx actually is international, especially when we having an international interview, we prefer WebEx rather than Zoom, but of course Zoom is popular internationally, so we have no problem having this kind of book. Okay, nowadays we already have open up our institution, and also the economy have been run as usual, and we have to accept that COVID is one of the disease, a regular disease happening local or Malaysian. So we have been introduced by hybrid teaching, which we are having now in terms of face-to-face and also in terms of online. So the face-to-face, we have camera like we are doing just now with ISIS Yogyakarta. There's a student there. I believe there's a student there. And also we have an online session. So hybrid learning is the trend in terms of teaching. Okay, even in UiTM also, we have a quite number of students. But since this week is actually a holiday for the student, it's a midterm break for them. Maybe that most of them are going to be in their houses, and also some of them are going to be in their hostel. So hybrid is trending now in terms of teaching. Okay, what problem facing is we have no line. We have thin line between our personal time and also working hours. We are working actually 24/7 when it comes to COVID. We not recognize our holiday. The holiday and also the weekend is actually equal. We are forgetting our need because we are just staying at home. We are most 24 hours in terms of platform. Either it's going to be in front of computer, or maybe a laptop, or maybe a tab, or maybe in our handphone. We are most of what is our time is towards gadget. Okay, so we are having overlapping and intertwined with our wife in terms of our work. We have. I remember when I did one of the session during my time as the coordinator in research under Dr. Hema. I've been posting all the session to all the lecturer. So I forgot actually the one of the session is actually under Hari Raya Adha. I forgot that I have to change it back because we are forgetting actually about our time of working. We are still working on online. Since we are not going out or meeting other people, so we just through online. So we are forgetting. We have no time that and it became equal in terms of life daily. So what effects in terms of life is of course the income. Everybody, all the income, even though from student and also from the educator, is quite have been affected because of this pandemic. And in terms of artists and also galleries, quite often have to be closed because people are not going to be out then the project has been cancelled, the exhibition has been cancelled, it's going to be quite the hassle for the artist sources of income. But luckily, because of the COVID as well, we are forced to have a new form of doing some kind of presentation. And this COVID is actually a starting point for the artists or the practitioner all the around the world, like artists, architect, gallery, museum, to have an alternative to be expand their visual art industry. Okay, so one of it is by using virtual. Okay, by in term of you because people are now started to go online more and more. So one by you using virtual is one of the alternative platform that been cover up most of the program. Is actually let everyone know who's the internet connecting browse working in term of art. And another one thing, because before this is our obligation to have a face-to-face or the physical space, by this having a virtual is actually a liberation for the art to be in term of virtual face. And also actually help the outgrown the industry, especially in term of new ways to digital profile most of the artwork and also the person itself. Okay, so now people are doing visual art exhibition. Okay, it's actually for us in UiTM, especially for Faculty of Art and Design, it's already fit in the curriculum, since we already have quite numbers of students have been graduate using a platform because of COVID, especially in postgraduate. We have two semesters already they have been teaching fully on the system of DL. So visual art exhibition actually help us quite a numbers to promoting student artwork. Okay, it's a great opportunity and also for them to share their artwork towards parents and also teachers and their friends and also their colleagues. And also they help the exhibitor to allow them to use this kind of visual platform. Okay, in terms of activity that we're having in UiTM, most of this us have been using quite a number of platform. For example, when we meet up with our dean, we are having a platform by using WebEx. So meaning everything in the admin already moves towards the platform. Since we are having a SOP, not quite we're having a there's not going to be a many in terms of people in the OD. So one of the alternatives is good to have this kind of platform. Even when we have a talk, our chancellery are giving a talk, they also open up a channel towards YouTube. So all over Malaysian state that have, for information, UiTM have a quite numbers of campuses in around the state. So it's a good platform to have a YouTube channel so that every staff can hear what the talk are being given by our chancellery. And also we had now actually we are having a program as well with the UTAS. Actually we are having a double program. One is program with the ISIS, and also we have also have a program with the UTAS. So this is actually quite a last year program, which are talking about the memorandum agreement and also a talk that fully been using a visual platform like YouTube and also Zoom and FB. Okay. So quite a numbers now actually move towards the platform of visual in UiTM. Okay, this is a talk. Mr. Rahman Amin is actually a staff in Faculty of Art and Design Fine Art Department. She's been called to give a talk about a new norm from the our TV commercial, TV Satu in local Malaysia. This is also been broadcast in YouTube, okay? And then also our students have been called also as well to know how they learn about this new term, this norm. So also it's been called broadcast by TV Satu, and also TV Satu have a platform in YouTube, so everybody can watch it. Okay. So also again, quite numbers of our staff in art and design being called to share their experience and also their how they teach, especially in term of practice design or and also creative design in the platform. Okay. For the past postgraduate study, we have a platform. Is actually a virtual platform that all the postgraduate, not only from art and design faculty, but also from other faculty, been introduced by this platform. So I think numbers of student, maybe if you're going to join master or PhD program, you can always enter here and have a look. And also they have been giving a live chat if you're going to ask something about the need in the this program. Okay, they're having some kind of visual communication here, chat room. Okay, so in postgraduate also we have a some kind of visual 1 week open day, and along with my colleague, my boss, Assistant Professor Dr. Rosita, she's the head of the program from Faculty of Design, and my colleague, Dr. Mastura, she's the coordinator for the coursework program. So me as a coordinator for research, so we are having a talk, quite numbers of talk actually, to tell about this program to all students who want to continue their study in term of master and PhD. Okay. So I think we have this we have quite a number from Indonesia actually have been join us to hear our presentation in term of promoting our postgraduate study in Faculty of Fine Design. This is actually a bit of one of the platform using by postgraduate coursework master. They having a session of 3 minutes, which the student have been present their research in three minutes, only 3 minutes. So all the panel and also the student and also moderator have been held in this platform. This we are using Google Meet. So they are going to share their presentation and also their talk among the student to the panel to share. Okay, and also postgraduate coursework, they have some kind of team that been inviting all the panel to giving a talk. They have a board in term of IG and also Facebook to be shared among other people, audience, in student, and also others. For research, actually, I'm also inviting quite a number of lecturer to be joined to have a talk, especially in term of research. For example, the preparation, how to do a research proposal and thesis, and also talk by our dean about their artistic research. So quite a number of platform we are using, and also visual we are using to share knowledge to our student, even though student cannot come to UiTM. All the platform is actually been used, WebEx, Gmail. So most of the platform is visual. This is quite the online activity that we are being used. Before the pandemic, we used to have Viva session face to face. Okay, we have going to have a session like this. The panel and also the moderator and also the student present their viva. This is a viva panel by the during the session. And now all the viva session have been used because of COVID. We are using a platform of Google Meet to meet, and the student are been presenting their research thesis. This is a master research viva, okay? And also this is a PhD. Okay, so meaning by research, most of the during COVID, we having all the session using Google Meet, okay? Luckily for us, we have this is so this is student presentation view. I was talking about their perspective there. So meaning we are inviting their supervisor and also the panel to hear the presentation from the student. Okay, this also a PhD student presentation for Viva. Also again the student and also the panel and also the supervisor are inside the platform. Okay, this is one of the also a presentation which Dr. Yul is actually one of the examiner. I've been called to examine the student of PhD. So we have a quite link between UIT and also the ISIS program. So Dr. Yul is one of the examiner, external examiners, and hopefully we can have a lot of number of the lecturer from that side to be our examiner in our local Viva section. Okay, we also having our Chinese interview using a WebEx, since Chinese quite they have a hassle in term of Google because of the country restriction using platform outside of China. So we WebEx is one of the convenient to use to have the interview section. And some of the my student from Chinese also, they have to buy VPN to install the WebEx, to install the WhatsApp. And luckily for me, quite a number of my students from China installing WhatsApp and try to call me and also video call me and talk about their research. I'm lucky to have that particular kind of student to what we call they're willing to sacrifice to have a connection with the supervisor. Okay, so we are calling actually when we having a student interview to Chuxing, we are calling for their agent to join us as well. So some of the we have a quite a barrier language between us and also Chinese. So we are hoping to have an agent to come join us during the session to help us as well. So this is session being held towards the interview of Chinese student. This is what I'm being moderate before my position in postgraduate. So I'm hoping Dr. Emma, this is actually when we are having a COVID, the idea come to having a platform to occupy all the lecturer and the student to have some kind of reinteraction between it. So we are calling all the lecturer in UITM to be giving a talk, and most of the time I'm the moderator. But then since this is quite a number honor to have me as a speaker here. Okay, quite a number here. Okay, this is a talk that I've been given, a sharing session view that I've been sharing with you all. So quite a number there. And also I'm after that, Dr. Associate Professor Dr. Fadilah been called to help her student in terms of learning in research. So been called to help in understanding about the method, the research, and also she's been going quite a number of local ITM and also local university to help her student in terms of teaching research. Yeah, her PhD, most of the student of her PhD student. Okay, we also have been called to join a participant collaboration with other university. I think you can have a look quite numbers. Dr. Mumtaz is actually a quite popular person to be giving talk towards the internationally, since she's quite a number of students have been graduated. So most of the students have been called back her to be giving talk. So I think you're going to have a session tomorrow with her, and hopefully you're going to join her as well to know about her topic. Okay. Her topic is quite interesting, about talking about digital 5.0. So in terms of Malaysian education. Okay. So this is a Faculty of Art, Design Fine Art staff doing a visual exhibition, and I'm one of the artists there joining this exhibition, and also I'm one of the MC handling this session as well. So we're having a platform there, a visual exhibition. So this platform being used to help us, especially in fine art. This exhibition is for fine art. We are calling all the fine art department all over the state. We fine art is actually quite numbers of having their program in Shah Alam, of course, and also in Melaka, Perak, and or Kelantan. So we are calling all the lecturer in fine art to have our visual exhibition promoting ourselves. In terms of, we are not going to stop in term, in art, even though COVID have been captured us. Okay, so now also students have been moved to this kind of platform to have their visual and their presentation using visual platform. This is a platform Mobrix is actually the textile students, so they're having a background there, all be quite equal to have this kind of session. And also down there is also the fine art student being having a session of their exhibition as well. Okay, so quite a numbers now, a student undergraduate, this most of the posters is undergraduate student from fine art, from fashion, and also from jewelry, and also for industry, having this platform of visual to exhibit, to share their exhibition, their artwork towards online. Okay, and also we also move from post graduate, we also move to platform. This is actually they're having a launch in term of ebook. So meaning all their work are being screened in term of ebooks. So they're having a launching this ceremony to launch their ebook exhibition. This is a student being fully ODS session. So we are lucky to have them fully certified in terms of learning, even though everything been teach by only online. Okay. So this is a fine art student which they're having a session. They're sharing some of their work. Quiz session is usually very common in fine art, which they have to present their ideas. So this is how their impression being used, being given to share their ideas to our staff. Okay, so this is quite a number of students have been presenting their first impression towards the idea development in their artwork. Okay, and nowadays, since we already open up our studio and also our session to student, especially for final year, so of course the SOP is very strict. So you can have a look our in fine art painting. There's a quite the SOP have been to constrain our staff. And also you can have a look on the right side. There's a printing using a technology, and also quite a few numbers inside there, because in term of we cannot having a quite numbers on student inside our session. So this is some kind of hybrid learning. So meaning even though the lecturer and a few numbers student in the workshop, still student in the in hostel or also in their houses, I've been also as well been catch up with this learning progress. Okay, so what's next for the arts in Malaysia? For me, artists develop continuous and excuse are not for future. So meaning, even though we're having a quite number of problem, especially near COVID, we are being captured ourselves, restraining, sitting at home, but for us, artists, art educator, development of art still growing, and hopefully to be grown and without excuse in future. Okay, with that, thank you all. Okay, maybe back to you, Mr. Of Travis, our moderator.
Okay, right. Thank you, Dr. Vanessa Miati, for your interesting topic and material that you delivered. Okay, I would like to invite for all the participants either here on this floor to if you want to ask anything, a question or discussion while you're having your refreshment course. And we also invite the participants who want to ask you want to put your question by chat. By the way, I also have maybe a little bit for discussions. We also experience a similar situation here that most of activities rapidly change to online medium. And even some of our students, even ourselves, we have this kind of effect that some have a negative effects, but some others they are positive. Since the online platform they expand rapidly and they break the space and time, it's quite often that we have a lot of agendas, online agenda, Zoom every time, and they have a lot of so. Even some of our students, they experience like a Zoom fatigue. They they feel tired of having a video online lots of time. And some of our colleagues, our officers, they can't have a meeting till late of night, because usually at the office we can do that, but using this digital technology, suddenly it's we can do this anytime. When was the last total lockdown in Malaysia?
Most of us in 2020, early April is quite around 6 months. It's a totally lockdown. Then after that, we try to open up to to the economy in term of to buy something, groceries is open, but in term of institution, we still close, and we are forced to teach online.
No, so
2020, last year.
In Indonesia, the last time we had the total lockdown was, I think, September 2020. We still have that problem. So it's very, very serious that the government have to put the restriction for the movement and etc. So it's very difficult for us.
Yeah. Okay. Actually, we are just open up. We just open up actually for Faculty of Fine Design. They just accepting student to come back to the our faculty to learn here. But we only open up for the final year student. All. So, but for our staff, we are being we have to go to office. Because everything has been for staff is actually everything have to be back to normal, but for the student, only for the final student. So other students still been learning as ODM.
Yeah, in our institution, we start to have like a hybrid and offline since October. But before that, totally online.
Totally online. Yeah, we have a student, quite a number of students have been graduate. Because of this online postgraduate already we have two batch already in graduate of using the ODL system, and in the undergrad we already have one batch that totally ODL. So it's quite a different need. Before this, we are being forced to constrain ourselves. We are forced to stay at home. Now, even though we are being opened back our life to the need, we have a problem that we need to stay at home, even though we already open, because the numbers of, even though we already been vaccinated, but we still afraid of going out, since still quite a numbers of death in Malaysia. So quite hazard in that particular something.
Okay. All right. Okay, we already have some questions. Yeah, we can find two in the chat, and maybe the first one is from Martinus B. Marianto. Okay. In dealing with the problems related to COVID-19, I wonder what a local wisdom or traditional ways of surviving, or in peribahasa, like a saying or proverb, frequently appear in people's conversations when they talk about the pandemic condition. For example, in Indonesia, many people often say that tenang, or relax. jangan lupa bahagia. Don't forget to stay happy and to keep their healthiness up. So that's a the question.
Okay, Malaysia actually we don't have some kind of peribahasa, but we always say kita jaga kita, meaning we have to take care of ourselves and also people around us. So kita jaga kita. Maybe that answer your question. Okay. Kita jaga kita. Local Malaysia used to use that.
All right, and then the second one from Ninus Anusapati. Okay, do you think this situation is just temporary and things are going back to normal? Or you think that the disruption means a total change for the whole education system?
So, I think the need of hybrid learning is actually a good system, actually, which I know some of the parents are scared to let their children go to the campus. So hybrid is actually a good system using both. Somehow it helped in terms of income, because some of the students, especially parents, are being affected in income. They have to pay their fees in terms of institution. And since when they have to go back to their faculties, their universities, they have to pay their the way to hostel and also their travel need. So in terms of hybrid, actually, it helped quite a number of students to generate. Since some I know some of the students also they having a part-time job to help their parents. So maybe we never know that there's going to be a new norm or maybe a new education or university using this system of hybrid. Because ITM try to do fully ODL system. We are trying to have that particular system fully ODL, which internationally can be learned in term of local program. Okay, so I think the need of face-to-face is actually is good because he helped us, especially in term of practitioners. Because if you are doing most of the online, it's quite a hazard because we are going to show, we have to lecturer, they have to have a background of their working area, something. So somehow face-to-face is also a need, it's a must actually. But knowing that we are going to having a quite number of facing, even though maybe COVID already done, but it still have any effects to other people. So hybrid is quite similar, maybe exchange first, but like what UITM have been done, first you have faces, first faces are being student from undergraduate for semester, first year semester. So lecturer are being teaching them basic in terms of drawing, the practice and technique. Then after that, they have to change back, coming back other university, other semester, other years to be in UITM. So hybrid, for me, hybrid help us actually in terms of learning in the education system. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for your response. Yeah, I agree. I don't agree more on most of your responses. And in here, in some of, I think most of my colleagues, they also find the hybrid is quite, a good system that can be used more in the future. I but sometimes I also worried about some of other subject that need to be done offline that can be a burden for some educator to transfer their knowledge. I believe that I think most of us believe that we will find a way to make this better in the future and maybe to prevent other problems ever appear again. The next question is from Yulita. Is there any difficulty to teach on is there any difficulty to teach on practice lecturing where before the pandemic the student was supposed to give assistance directly where the lecturers should check the student work in directly offline this is for especially for the practice if there's any difficulties you found there.
Yeah, actually it's quite difficult to have online, especially in terms of practice. If you are teaching drawing and your student has 20 student in the class, every student have to be proceed by the lecturer, right? So it's quite a hazard when the student have to show in terms of online. So meaning student have to upload it in the system or present it using PowerPoint, and the lecturer have been giving quite a numbers of time to hear and a patience to hear every student. For example, if you have 20, you have to 20 student to be here their idea. And sometimes when we are try to criticize their work, we are giving a same comment. For example, maybe quite a number of students are being comment the same. You have to put a line there, make it a shadow, the colors is using itself. It's some kind of you are repeating. If you have a student 20, you need to repeat 20. Okay, it's quite challenges and for the lecturer to be have a quite a patient to repeat again and again for among the student. And also some of the student wish because of time limit and also the student representation. So most of us also been giving a chance for the student to send their idea towards WhatsApp. So for the lecturer being teaching this practical studio base, their WhatsApp and their image of student going to be full storage of images of student submitted their idea towards WhatsApp. So it's quite hassle actually. So in terms of practice, actually it's good to have face to face. But since we are COVID, again, hybrid is an alternative to exchange. First, maybe 10 students are being come first for the face-to-face and after that change it. So it's good to have some kind of this platform. But again, it's quite as a lecturer in practice base, you have you need to have this kind of patient, outstanding patient to be teaching this kind of practice. Okay.
Yeah. I think. I have one experience with that. Since we administrate of the some of the lecturer to teach whether they want to do the lecture or not. I remember that one of the lecturer who teach acting in our institution. Usually, he was a regular teacher before the pandemic. But when the pandemic strike, he tried to do it online just one semester, and then after that, he decided to stop.
Okay, yeah.
He found that he couldn't transfer the knowledge and all the expression of his body and his facial expression through the online. So he decided to stop until there's another way to do it better, maybe.
Yeah, actually being a lecturer is more stressful than being a student actually. But most of us come across students are being complaining, they are being captured sitting around in houses doing nothing. But actually being a lecturer is you need to have a quite big patience and stress. You need to have their engagement of melter head is quite big for me. And it's good. Actually, people, a lecturer who survive in term of COVID is actually, they are very good. They're very good for me.
Okay. Maybe for the, I also invite for all the participants or the attendants here. Maybe you can also have a direct discussions.
Yeah.
Or maybe Mr. Liu, maybe want to share something with Dr. Anita. Yeah, because I know that you both also have a corporation. But okay, for the next question, from Sujud Dartanto. During the pandemic situation, how to solve the problems of digital divided in our society? Where the students come from it? As we know, there's problem of technology engagement. That's a question.
We are having a problem in terms of connecting internet actually, in terms of gadget or in terms of gadgets, apps, we have no problem because everything is in terms of already technologies. But in terms of online, even in UITM, we have difficulties on having online because the internet seems to be have a quite challenges for us in educator. That's why for today I have to manage it from home because of it's better line here in home rather in faculty. But tomorrow, since we're having a meeting, I have to go back to our faculty to having a meeting there and also a Viva there. So our problem is line. It's not about the application or maybe the use of a tablet or computer, but the line, that one, I think only the government have to do something in terms of line. The technology online is quite, even sometimes we're having a difficult doing our meeting and also our Viva, the line, especially, for example, when from Viva PhD, we have international staff, lecturer, to become our panel of examiner. So sometimes we are calling them outside Malaysia using this platform of online, and they are sometimes they're having difficulties to contact online. So line is our enemy, actually. It's not the technology, but the line is actually our enemy. Okay, I think that's it lah, the line. Some government have to do something, but at the same time, actually, we are forcing ourselves to have this kind of need, this technology of need. We everybody, even babies or children, youngest, they already expose us with this technology of using tablet, handphone. Actually, it's not good, but we are forcing our student and also our child to have this technology because it's nowadays is a need. It's not the necessary. It's a need to have this engagement of technology. But again, our enemy is line. It's good to have a problem of line, actually, when we have a problem of line. So student, so the children have to go watch others or play with others a toy. But again, it's a need. Line of message and technology is our need nowadays. So to solve it, we have to talk with the government, I think. A political, it's something to do with political need. So something like that lah. Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, sometimes I also think that maybe the pandemic came at the right time. I don't wish that ever came. But I mean, if the pandemic happened maybe 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Or maybe 20 years ago, when our technology is not this advanced, it will be more depressing for us when we have this lockdown and we couldn't contact any of our peers or colleagues or our families. It will be very, very much difficult for most of us. So yeah, in this perspective, we are lucky, but not that lucky, but yeah.
Sometimes I wonder since I'm also during my time of born, actually we are not a technology advanced and everything using our knowledge to search. For example, I've been thinking, how can I go to that place using, nowadays we have ways or something, right, to indicate or to guide us to in terms of way. But before this, we can go there without this application. Right? Now we need them. We need this application to help us. But during my time of children, we have no this application and we survive. Right, we are surviving our life in term without this new technology, new app. But now, again, it's a need. And we are forcing ourselves to have this kind of technology. The quite a number of buildings, we got confusing because during my our session, maybe do long time ago, the technology is not quite good, and the building is just a simple building. And we're going to remember every landmark there in the place. But now, since there are quite a number of buildings, and we got confusing, and we need this kind of technology to help us. So technology is a need nowadays, even though actually we can survive with that technology, but somehow it's actually helping us in terms of processing and also knowing all the data. And now this, some student, when enter my class, I'm teaching most of the subject is in terms of lecture session, in terms of historical. When I'm asking them, then they don't have their answer. I ask them, open up your Google, try to search now in terms of using the handphone. It's even though it's some kind of funny for me as a lecturer to ask the student to open up their Google handphone, but actually it's help actually to help the student fastening their processing in terms of searching using this kind of technology.
Yeah, it's really opened a lot of opportunities. Maybe we can go for the next question. From Muhammad Aldi. I wonder about Zoom fatigue. Is there any particular methods you personally apply to prevent students become bored with the amount of times they must attend an online class or two, which were sometimes it takes 1 to 2 hours for just staring at the screen and sometimes 5 minutes break. Or just not working plainly, or even question and answer or discussion, and so on. Okay, so the question is on the first part of the topic, about how to prevent students become bored with the amount of lot of Zoom.
Actually, having a technology, for example, I have a student from Chinese student international. We have an English barrier. Chinese students are quite having difficulties to talk in English. So we call agent to join us, to help us, rather to explain them in term, maybe in take about 30 minutes, since we have an English barrier. And you're using their agent to translate, it's going to take hours. It's something like that. When we have, if we are in term of face to face and we meet personally with that particular person, we can learn their body language, their expression, the way they're moving their hand, the way they're standing. Body language is actually important in term of education. So without having this kind of face-to-face, we only see our surface in terms of faces. There are so many, it's going to be boring, especially for the student. Sometimes I come across my student when I've been giving lecture, they do other works, they do their studio-based work. But for me, as long you open up your camera and hear what I'm taught, it's okay. But yes, you need to have this body language. For example, when we are giving lecture in terms of studio, I usually to walk around. So I'm going to find out which student are not looking at me. When I walk around in this space of classes, when we walk, and also we having our body language, student can capture rather than having this online. Okay, so they have to progress or meaning to download the need of lecture, having giving lecture, even though sometimes as a student, BSF also still learning in terms of progress. We have a session of a webinar something, we can only manage 30 minutes in the early session. And after that, we're going to be having a board and also maybe kita lapar. So maybe you're going to have difficulties. It's actually body language is one of the need in term of to maybe some maybe upcoming technology, a visual visual surface or maybe a Android is going to be conquered later on in term of surface in we are having a quite number of TV program having a quite a visual realities using this helmet or something, because we need this body language. This body language actually helping us, especially helping students as well to execute being bored online. Okay.
Yeah, I remember one quote from Jurassic Park. Life will find a way. yeah, if we face difficulties in any way, we will find how to solve it. And everybody is creative, and they will have something to solve daily problems and make life better. One thing that I really miss from the direct engagement is the direct response from the audience. For example, usually in during the lecture, I throw some jokes. Actually, I can hear their response.
They're laughing. Yeah.
But using the Zoom or video conferences, I can't hear anything. So I don't know how they respond, whether the jokes work or not.
Sometimes during our lecture, their parents also join us to hear our talk. Actually, to when we give meaning, when they are at the home, a student actually exposing us to their parents as well. So, as a lecturer, you have to be careful if you did condemning their children or something, because they are at home and the parents are looking at you. At the same time, as a lecturer, they have to give. To teach them so that the student have to focus, so meaning the interactive, so it's good to have body language kan? A new technology with the new progressing, we're going to have a full video and teaching them. And some of the students, sometime in the morning, they go, especially for me, your ITM, the student, most of the student, women, student, ladies, they are wearing their tudung. So meaning sometimes they are not preparing to have a class. So they used to have offline web, which can sometimes I've been forcing them to open up so that I can have a view, full pictures of them, what they are doing. And sometimes we have to respect them because of the session, they have been difficulties of morning, something, right? So it's quite hazard there. Okay.
Yeah. By the way, I'm happy to say that we have a lot of questions.
Okay? Yeah.
It will. I think they will keep us on until 3 o'clock.
yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, but I will select some of the questions.
Yeah, sure.
Maybe okay. Okay. There's a short question from Virus Nur Afifa. Is double tap love in Instagram? I don't use Instagram a lot, but maybe you understand what it. In a virtual exhibition case, whether it's able to guarantee that the public understand an artist's work in depth. The question is on the chat, whether the double tap is reliable. I think that's the question.
In virtual exhibition, actually, there's a platform being used most of us in UITM. I forgot the platform name, but actually there's is a visual where we enter some kind. It's like having actually we are there, but in terms of online. Okay, meaning there is entrance, there start walking there, everything. So quite a numbers exhibition now students are using that particular platform in terms of visual. So meaning there's a artwork hanging on the wall. You are actually being visual inside this particular platform. Okay, so it's nice actually. Even though it's online, so the problem is we need to have this such good line to have this to go to this platform. Okay, because it's going to be heavy. Quite hazard of the standing or everything, but it's nice to have this kind of platform visual. And I think a lot of others platform are being another one thing by having this actually is an income for the exhibition exhibitor to have this what call this application. So rather than what you are renting the surface of the exhibition rent, and maybe you can also rent this kind of platform for others to use this kind of technology, and it's actually helping in terms of income, because you need to be patient in it's the same actually in the real exhibition. You have to place their artwork, you have to have this platform of promoting something like that. It's the same, only that the difference is either is just visual, so meaning or everything in online. So it's good, actually it's good a good started for us in educator and also curator, as also gallery and museum to have this new kind of engagement of platform. Okay,
thank you for your response. We still have a few more minutes. But I think there's. Yeah, anyone who want to ask directly, please.
Hello, I'm Ripka Febriani. I want to ask a question related to the previous question. Do you think it is important to consider duration of an online meeting? And do you think it affects participants' excitement to the meeting? Because the longer the meeting was held, it usually less information participants can absorb. So the first speaker, maybe the participant pay attention more, and on the end of the meeting, the maybe third speaker, the participant can absorb information less than in the first speaker. What's your opinion about this, and is there any solutions? Thank you.
Actually, if you're looking at now, all the speakers are giving you a quite different title. So I don't think it's going to be less excitement talking about other speakers. So if you're going, for example, if you are in the term of postgraduate, one of the session is you have to present your paper. So if you go towards the paper presentation, it's going to be a different presentation towards the research being held. So even though you are in the same room, other speakers, other presenter is going to be giving a different kind of situation and need of according to the presentation. So I don't think it's going to be less in terms of the excitement. The difference is the time. Mungkin maybe now in Indonesia time is around 11, your local Malaysia is around 12. Mungkin lapar kot. Hungry is one of the factors being captures for people to keep in their concentration. But if you're going to have that particular session, in the evening session, after you having this kind of meal, heavy meal, is also going to affect your concentration. So meaning, either situation is up to you actually. People are going to have a different excitement according to the need of different title of their presentation. To tell the truth, actually, even most of the research have been executed. Most of the people can be concentrated around 3 minutes earlier. So meaning most of the lecturer are going to give everything, or a speaker going to be everything in terms of 3 minutes earlier. Then after that, you're going to have a session, a Q&A, to cool it up down. So meaning when the participant have a problem to understand something, they can answer that or question it that again. So they're going to be the knowledge are going to be shared again. So I don't think it's going to be less assignment for you, since after my session is going to have another session, going to be given another talk, another sharing. So you're not going to be bored. Don't worry. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for your opinion. Yeah. Maybe for the last question that I'm going to choose is from, I think I'm going to pick the last one. It's from Suwarno Wisetrotomo. Good morning, Dr. Samyati Andriana. In the context of resilience and sustainability, what are the things that are missing and emerging in the artistic and aesthetic aspect of art practice in Malaysia?
Okay, the problem is we cannot see it real. Okay, for example, in terms of sculpture presentation, if you're going to have in terms of online, you only see in a surface in terms of 2D dimensional work. But if you go towards this real life thing, the feeling is going to be different. Okay, the feeling of being in that particular era, that particular space is going to be different in terms of having just online. So the aesthetic or the beauty is going to be a different kind of feeling. So for me, we still need to have this space of exhibition face to face, and also people who maybe our all artists, they have parents, right? So meaning when the parents are maybe they cannot be absent in terms of this real space. Online is good for them to help them to give to tell our parent that we have our student have this kind of exhibition. For example, like mine, I'm local. I'm staying in Shah Alam, and my parent in Seremban. Having this platform actually give them to see me personally live, but having actually the real. Is going to be a different situation, and also the feel is going to be different. But it's help. Other than that, it's help. But we need both actually. We need having real and also having this platform. So the aesthetic is going to be it's up to you. It's very the value is going to be either one of the. It's subjective and also objective. But then when you're talking about art, it's quite rather B2B subjective. So it's a subjective thing. It's going to be different people, got different need, and also different kind of excitement. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Wan. Okay, but due to the time limitation, I'm afraid have to question.
Okay.
So I would like to invite all the participants here to send your huge appreciation for Dr. Wan. I give a big applause.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all.
And thank you for your insight and knowledge. Okay. Yeah. I'm going to return my duty to the Master of Ceremony. I think we can have 5 minutes less at this.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Octavianus. Thank you, Dr. Wan Samyati, for the interesting topic. I think as a student myself, I think I can say on behalf of most students that joining a 7 a.m. Zoom meeting versus being physically there for a 7 a.m. class is more tiring. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of the first lecture, and in a few minutes, we will continue to our next lecture with Dr. Swastiwi MDes presenting new ways of designing. If you register for this lecture, please stand by, and if we part ways here, thank you for participating. Good afternoon. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Untuk menyaksikan metafor-metafor baru, ide baru, konsep baru yang saya yakin memiliki banyak kejutan dan aspek novelty yang kita butuhkan untuk membangkitkan ide-ide kita sendiri. Acara keseluruhan akan diselenggarakan di gedung Ajijasa Fakultas Seni Rupa ISI Yogyakarta. Pamerannya diselenggarakan secara luring dan secara daring. Kuliah dari dosen tamu juga di sana. Lihat, perhatikan, ambil hikmahnya. Bagaimana mereka menghadirkan representasi yang non benda itu menjadi karya gelaran kreatif. Survivability dan the art. Kita sekarang sadar bahwa ketika orang membuat karya seni, membuat desain, membuat karya kreatif, justru sekarang yang relevan justru survivability dan the art. Kita sekarang sadar bahwa ketika orang membuat karya seni, membuat desain, membuat karya kreatif, justru sekarang yang relevan justru aspek intangible-nya. Yang dibuat itu justru yang menarik aspek non-bendanya. Cerita yang... Survivability dan the art. Kita sekarang sadar bahwa ketika orang membuat karya seni, membuat desain, membuat karya kreatif, justru sekarang yang relevan justru aspek intangible-nya. Yang dibuat itu justru yang menarik aspek non-bendanya. Cerita yang dihadirkan melalui karya kreatif, apakah fine art atau desain, karya-karya kreatif mereka dengan instalasi, yang video dan performance art, refleksi dari mereka berbagi cerita bagaimana mereka merasakan secara global dalam kondisi seperti sekarang ini, yang mereka metaforkan dan melalui art, karya-karya kreatif mereka. Kita sekarang yang sadar merupakan refleksi dari keadaan yang sama. Desain membuat karya kreatif. Melihat, justru sekarang yang relevan justru aspek intangible baru. Yang ide dibuat baru, itu konsep justru baru, yang menarik yang saya aspek non bendanya memiliki banyak kejutan. Cerita yang dihadirkan melalui karya kreatif kita butuhkan, apakah the fine art atau desain sendiri, atau barangkali dengan instalasi video dan diselenggarakan di gedung mereka berbagi cerita bagaimana mereka survive dalam kondisi seperti sekarang ini. Pameran yang mereka metaforkan secara luring dan secara daring, karya-karya kreatif mereka.
Kuliah dari bintang tamu
juga di sana, refleksi dari keadaan yang sama-sama kita rasakan secara global. Untuk melihat, untuk menyaksikan metafor-metafor baru, ide baru, konsep baru yang saya yakin memiliki banyak kejutan dan aspek novelty yang kita butuhkan untuk membangkitkan ide-ide kita sendiri. Acara keseluruhan akan diselenggarakan di gedung Aji Jasa Fakultas Seni Rupa.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya. Good morning. Honorable invited guests and peers at Gedung Aji Jasa, Faculty of Visual Arts, and participants who joined via Zoom, welcome and welcome back to Guest Lecture Series and International Visual Art Exhibition, Survivability and the Arts. Thank you for your patience. We can now continue to our second lecture of the day. Before we start, I will read the items of our lecture. The first session is the presentation by our lecturer, Dr. Swastiwi Mdes, and afterwards, there will be a Q&A session. Ladies and gentlemen, before we begin, let me remind everyone in the building to be mindful of the health protocol and put on your masks at all times. Now, without further ado, let's begin our next lecture titled New Ways of Designing, presented by Dr. Swastiwi Mdes. I will give the floor to our moderator, Mr. Octavianus Cahyono Prianto.
Okay, thank you, Dara. Welcome back to the second day of our lecture series, and this will be our second session, and we will have Dr. Swastiwi, Master of Design, who will present her material called New Ways of Designing. Okay, before we give time for the presentation, I will introduce you to Dr. Swastiwi Pilatmojo, Master of Design. Okay, she teaches in the Department of Interior Design, Faculty of Visual Arts, Institut Seni Indonesia, Yogyakarta. In Indonesia, the COVID-19 curve has begun to decline. That's our topic for today. Yeah, but we face a greater danger, namely the environmental crisis. The world has laid out a new agenda of change in 2015, referred to as the Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs. The UN expects the support of all parties to achieve these goals. Building a sustainable living environment is a shared responsibility of the creators of the man-made worlds, including designers. Transition design is an approach option that offers new ways of designing to achieve sustainable building design, encouraging local wisdom utilization. On these occasions, three cases of sustainable design were presented that raised local wisdom as example of new ways of design. Okay. Without further ado, I'm going to pass the screen to Dr. Swastiwi. Okay. The screen is yours.
Terima kasih kepada Mas Oce sebagai moderator pagi hari ini. And I would like to say thank you also to the Dean of the Faculty of Visual Art Pak Timur Raharjo, and also the committee who already gave the opportunity to me to give this lecture. It is such a pleasure to see all the students directly in this room. And hopefully with this lecture, we can have something new, something happy than before, because we already 1.5 years not meeting each other. So this is the good time to see each other. And as you know, maybe I would like to give the lecture in Indonesia and also maybe mix up with the English, because I believe that many of the audience is Indonesian, so maybe Indonesia is better than I give in English, which is maybe my English is not good enough, or what is it, sedikit kacau gitu ya. Jadi sebaiknya mungkin dalam bahasa Inggris, dalam bahasa Indonesia. Lecture saya tentang, sorry, I will share the screen to you. New ways of designing, ya. Kalau beberapa lecture yang tadi berbicara tentang apa yang sudah kita kerjakan selama ini, untuk lecture yang akan saya berikan lebih melihat ke depan. Jadi sebetulnya problem yang kita hadapi sekarang ini mungkin pandemik, ya. Di Indonesia sudah mulai turun ininya, curve-nya atau apa, curve ya, apa sih, trennya, perkembangannya atau ya pandeminya itu sendiri sudah turun. Kemudian ya di dunia sebetulnya sudah punya lebih banyak hope, lebih banyak harapan bahwa pandemi ini bisa teratasi nanti di awal 2022. Jadi dengan ditemukannya obat, kemudian juga vaksinasi sudah mungkin menjangkau 70% dari penduduk dunia mungkin, ya, atau 50% kalau misalnya targetnya tidak tercapai. Nah, pandemi ini sudah menurun, dan sebetulnya instead of the pandemic, there are great danger, ya, great problem to our society because of the environmental problem. Especially the climate change. The climate change is the problem which is really here. It's already here. Last week maybe, or 2 weeks ago, in Malang, there are flash flood. Okay. And then in Sintang, we have also have flood. Even in New York, they have floods. Yeah. So this is really serious problem to our society, or to the world. Yeah. UNEP say that actually three problem. Climate change, biodiversity, and also pollution is the main three problem of environmental degradation. So we only have 1 decade to overcome this. 1 decade is not very long. 10 tahun kita punya waktu untuk mengatasi itu. Kemarin ada COP26, bisa dikatakan gagal karena banyak target yang harus dicapai tidak tercapai oleh banyak negara. Seperti misalnya menurunkan emisi CO2, kemudian mengatasi sampah plastik dan sebagainya. Bahkan memberikan sumbangan dana untuk program-program environmental itu juga tidak terpenuhi. Jadi sebetulnya COP26 itu bisa dikatakan sesuatu yang glooming, ya, sesuatu yang tidak tercapai. Nah, sebetulnya konsep sustainability itu sudah hampir 30 tahun yang lalu dirumuskan ya. Tahun 1987 ketika Brundtland Commission melaunching buku tentang Our Common Future yang sudah merumuskan tentang apa itu sustainability. Sebetulnya sustainability itu adalah bagaimana kita melakukan pembangunan, tetap membangun diri kita ya, masyarakat kita, tapi tetap memikirkan generasi yang akan datang. Ya, bagaimana generasi yang akan datang masih tetap bisa menikmati hidup di dunia dengan baik. Kalau kita saat ini membiarkan hedonisme, membiarkan kenikmatan, membiarkan pertumbuhan terus-menerus, mungkin anak cucu kita tidak akan mendapatkan warisan, tidak akan mendapatkan kenikmatan-kenikmatan yang selama ini kita punyai ya. Jadi itu mengingat ke depan. Oleh karena itu saya merasa perlu mengatakan hal ini karena 10 tahun ke depan itu Anda semua yang jadi desainer ya. Jadi Anda atau desainer ataupun pencipta mungkin ya, kreator. Oleh karena itu ini betul-betul serius problem kerusakan lingkungan itu. Tadi selain sustainable development, kemudian di tahun 2015, di tahun 2000 itu mereka atau UNEP menyusun tentang MDGs ya, Millennial Development Goal, dan tahun 2015 menjadi SDGs atau Sustainable Development Goals, di mana mereka basisnya adalah mengatasi poverty, inequality, dan climate change. Tiga hal itu untuk SDG ya. Kemudian ada 17 goal, ada 17 tujuan-tujuan yang ingin dicapai. Nah, ini sebenarnya sudah dirumuskan, tapi seperti tadi disampaikan, banyak hal yang tidak bisa dicapai, banyak hal yang tidak bisa di target ya. Seperti kemarin misalnya Cina itu harus mengurangi emisi gasnya, emisi CO2-nya dari pabrik-pabrik itu mereka tidak mau. Atau India atau Amerika itu mereka ingkar janji terhadap kesepakatan di 2015 yang dibikin di Paris. Nah, ini semua adalah hal-hal yang harus kita hadapi ya. Seperti tadi, jadi kalau misalnya es di kutub meleleh, itu yang tenggelam tidak hanya Cina atau tapi negara lain ya. Jadi ini ada karakter juga dari ini setelah sustainable development saya masuk di gini ya, climate change ini. Climate change di situ kelihatan misalnya mengatakan karakteristik dari climate change itu borderless. Jadi terjadi es meleleh di kutub, tapi akibatnya itu ke seluruh global, ke seluruh dunia, ke seluruh bumi ya. Pulau yang tenggelam ataupun kota yang kemudian terkurangi karena air laut naik, atau kemudian iklim yang berubah sehingga ada hujan yang ekstrim gitu. Hujan yang ekstrim itu tadi menghasilkan tadi banjir atau flash flood ya, atau banjir bandang. Bulan Juni kalau tidak Juli itu di Jerman terjadi banjir bandang yang belum pernah terjadi sebelumnya dan korbannya banyak sekali, 150 orang meninggal. Kemudian di Cina juga terjadi 50 orang meninggal. Kalau di kita mungkin tidak terlalu banyak, tapi di sana itu sebuah peristiwa yang sebelumnya tidak pernah terjadi. Seperti tadi disampaikan di sini, itu borderless, kemudian juga impact-nya long term ya. Jadi bisa lama sekali. Problem es di kutub itu tidak bisa begitu saja kita stop. Kemudian berhenti dan kita hidup lagi normal. Itu tidak bisa kita stop. Dan kalau menyetop itu butuh waktu lama. Jadi masalahnya seperti itu. Apa untuk climate change itu? Seperti halnya misalnya ozon sudah bolong gitu ya. Untuk mengembalikan menutup ozon itu bukan sebuah usaha yang gampang gitu. Kemudian yang berikutnya adalah scientific base. Jadi untuk mengatasi masalah lingkungan itu harus berbasis science, tidak bisa tidak. Jadi tidak bisa eksperimental atau karena apa? Karena itu banyak hal-hal yang harus di-research, banyak hal yang harus dieksperimen, juga banyak hal yang harus dihitung secara kalkulasi yang scientific gitu ya. Itu masalah climate change ya. Nah, kemudian ini hanya menunjukkan saja, ini yang terakhir di Kanada ya. Ada banjir bandang juga, kemudian di Kota Batu Malang, ini yang di Jerman Selatan, kebakaran hutan di Spanyol, di California gitu ya. Di musim panas kemarin. Kemudian kekeringan di Afrika. Afrika ini menjadi benua yang paling menderita ya, karena sampai saat ini mereka belum maju. Mereka masih kekurangan, mereka masih miskin, mereka masih terbelakang. Tapi belum sampai mereka bisa menikmati kehidupan, itu akan dihantam dengan problem lingkungan yang akan menurunkan lagi taraf hidup mereka. Itu nasib dari Afrika ya. Kalau sekarang Anda lihat di siaran TV, Eropa itu lebih konsentrasi pada Afrika karena tadi melihat problemnya bagi masyarakat Afrika itu sangat sangat tidak bagus gitu ya. Nah, bagaimana peran desainer ya? Seperti tadi saya sudah sampaikan ada SDG ya. SDG itu agenda for change ya. Jadi di sini membutuhkan banyak inovasi, banyak pemikiran, banyak ide kreatif bagaimana mengatasi permasalahan dunia tadi, sustainable development ya. Kemudian di dalam karena problemnya yang sangat complicated, sangat luas, sangat mendunia gitu, sehingga everybody has a role ya. Jadi semua punya peran. Bahkan harus berperan ya, tidak bisa tidak. Harus berperan. Ini ada satu ungkapan dari Antonio Guterres ya, yang jadi Sekretaris Jenderal dari UN. Making peace with nature is the defining task of the 21st century. It must be the top priority for everyone, everywhere. Jadi semua memang harus merasa terlibat di dalam mengatasi permasalahan lingkungan. Yeah, at this stage, I must say that achieving sustainable development is the main task of the designer because designer are essentially creator of the man-made world. Yeah. Dalam definisi desain, biasanya disebutkan desainer itu inisiator dari perubahan, inisiator dari pembuatan dunia buatan manusia. Ya. Oleh karena itu, they must take responsibility. Ya, desainer itu harus mengambil tanggung jawab. And if necessary, be a leader in achieving the world welfare and sustainability goals. Itu saya pikir sebuah statement yang fair juga ya, karena ya memang seperti itu, kita tuh creator of the world. Jadi kita bertanggung jawab kalau ada masalah yang terkait dengan permasalahan lingkungan hidup. Nah, ini adalah pernyataan dari Mayer and Norman yang mengatakan designer nowadays are playing an increasing important role, not only designing conventional products, but also working outside the boundaries of their studio into the world of business, commerce, health, and even the environment. Mayer and Norman have grouped the challenge to design into four categories: performance challenges, systemic challenges, contextual challenges, and the global challenges. Ya, jadi seperti itu. Anda mungkin sekarang masih belajar pada satu bidang desain tertentu ya, tapi ketika Anda sudah selesai, Anda bisa mengembangkan diri dan masuk pada four layer of challenges ini. Tentu dengan Anda masuk pada layer-layer yang lebih atas, tentu menuntut kemampuan, menuntut kompetensi yang lebih juga. Nah, itu mungkin bisa Anda lakukan dengan apakah itu dengan praktik ataupun dengan sekolah lagi gitu ya. Jadi S2, S3 itu menjadi sebuah kesempatan untuk mengembangkan diri dan Anda terlibat dalam layer-layer yang lebih tinggi. Nah, ini yang ditawarkan oleh kalau tadi sekitar dirilis tahun 2020, yang ini dirilis tahun 2015 oleh Irwin, Tonkin-Wise, kemudian Kossoff dan Scovelli. Ini dari Carnegie Mellon ya, kalau tadi dari kayaknya dari Sydney. Ini dari Carnegie Mellon School of Design di Amerika. Ini tidak jauh berbeda, dia membagi area-area dari desain atau built world. Ini adalah subdisiplin dari desain, bisa produk, bisa communication, bisa environment. Kemudian desain for service ya. Jadi kita sekarang seperti kemarin menyusun protokol kesehatan, itu adalah pekerjaan desain. Itu bersifat sosial. Jadi kemudian menyusun protokol merawat orang sakit stroke misalnya, itu juga pekerjaan desain. Karena desain-desain yang ada di Eropa, ada di Amerika, itu bagaimana mendesain sebuah penjara agar penjara ini menjadi lebih baik. Jadi kita tuh bisa mendesain tadi perilaku, membuat sebuah sistem bagaimana penjara, bagaimana sekolah, bagaimana kantor menjadi sebuah tempat bekerja dan kemudian orang yang bekerja di situ itu menjadi lebih baik, welfare, lebih sejahtera, lebih bahagia, lebih. Jadi desain bisa sampai ke sana. Atau ini design for service, kemudian design for social innovation. Kemudian ada transition design itu ya. Transition design itu levelnya tadi, kalau dibandingkan dengan levelnya Norman tadi, bisa di dalam masalah dunia. Karena seperti tadi, masalah environment itu borderless, kemudian dia long term, kemudian dia juga scientific problem. Tapi perlu diingat juga bahwa di dalam bekerja di sini itu tidak lagi desainer sendiri ya. Desainer harus bekerja sama dengan bidang-bidang yang lain. Sehingga inilah yang membuat kemudian desainer itu bisa jalan kemana-mana, bisa masuk di bidang yang lebih luas, lebih dalam, itu karena memang kita tidak bekerja sendiri, tapi bekerja dengan ahli-ahli yang lain. Nah, kemudian di dalam transition design itu dia menawarkan seperti ini. Jadi ada 4 hal penting yang harus dipunyai untuk mereka yang akan bergerak di transition design, yaitu desain-desain yang lebih memihak pada sustainable. Mereka harus punya vision of transition, ya, harus punya visi untuk apa, berubah dari yang sekarang menjadi yang lebih baik. Nah, karena di situ ada perubahan, ada perubahan mindset, ada perubahan perilaku, ada perubahan culture, ya. Tidak hanya pikiran, tidak hanya gaya hidup gitu ya, tapi yang harus berubah culture. Masalah sampah aja ya, masalah sampah itu kan nggak bisa. Saya sudah, atau teman-teman atau banyak orang sudah terbiasa seperti ini, tapi tidak bisa berhenti di sini. Harus ada lagi apa yang berubah. Oleh karena itu yang berubah harus culture-nya. Kemudian juga di bawahnya ada theory of change. Jadi untuk mereka yang akan bekerja dengan sustainability, itu harus paham theory of change. Theory of change itu apa ya? Ya perubahan ya. Bagaimana sesuatu itu harus memahami proses alami atau proses buatan, kemudian bagaimana cara merubah. Tadi mungkin juga behavior itu bagaimana caranya berubah, kalau yang teknologi itu sifatnya bagaimana. Jadi theory of change itu lebih bagaimana kita, kalau kita merubah, tapi dengan tadi pertimbangan-pertimbangan saintifik. Jangan semata-mata eksperimental tanpa ini, tapi harus ada pemikiran-pemikiran yang berdasar. Kemudian ada postur mindset, ini adalah bagaimana mindset kita terbuka, positif, kemudian mau bekerja sama dan sebagainya ya. Kemudian baru kita sampai pada new ways of designing. Nah, saya tidak akan membicarakan ini semua, tapi membicarakan new ways of designing, di mana new ways of designing itu bisa kita lihat di sini. Jadi apa yang ditawarkan oleh Irvin tadi ada banyak ya, new ways of designing itu designing for initial condition, satu ya. Kemudian ada place-based, context-based design. Kemudian design for the next level or down in the system. Kemudian network alliance building. Kemudian transdisciplinary and co-design process. Kemudian yang berikutnya, design that amplifies grassroots effort. Kemudian beta error friendly approach to designing. Jadi ada 7 ya yang ditawarkan. Tapi tentu saja masih banyak hal yang lain ya. Di sini dia menawarkan 7. Nah, saya akan mencoba melihat bagaimana beberapa hal ini diaplikasikan di sini dan mengambil contoh dari karya-karya yang ada di sekitar kita. Ada 3 contoh yang akan saya tampilkan. Ini adalah Earth Manual Project yang dikerjakan oleh Ajeng bersama teman-teman di desain interior ketika mengikuti proyek kompetisi yang diadakan oleh Shigeru Bans yang bekerja sama dengan Japan Foundation dan jurusan arsitektur UGM. Ketika itu mempunyai program bagaimana membuat desain yang responsif terhadap bencana alam ya. Salah satunya kalau di Jogja itu kan ada eruption, ada gempa bumi, mungkin juga bencana yang lain ya. Nah, bencana itu juga menjadi salah satu ciri dari tadi climate change ya, yang harus kita hadapi. Nah, ini dia menawarkan ini ya, mitigation design, di mana dia membuat desain-desain perabotan, tapi terbuat dari sampah karton ya, sampah dus gitu ya, di mana di situ ada multifunction, easy to create, reuse material, resolve problem of needs ya. Jadi ini adalah desain apa? Niatan desainnya adalah untuk mengatasi mitigasi atau bencana, bagaimana selamat dari bencana atau bagaimana ya tetap hidup ketika bencana terjadi. Nah, ini beberapa apa? Foto-foto dari karyanya. Jadi memang dibuat dari karton yang ada. Sorry. Di sini practically is a keyword ya. Jadi dia mengatakan bahwa praktikalitas adalah kata kuncinya. Di mana di situ perabotnya itu bisa dipakai untuk menyimpan sesuatu untuk to store on it dan store on in it dan on it, kemudian juga untuk tidur dan untuk duduk ya. Oleh karena itu dia memakai memakai karton ini sebagai sarana, mungkin ini dipakai di tempat-tempat pengungsian gitu ya. Nah, ini salah satu dosennya Pak Anom itu juga ada di sini di belakang. Jadi ini desain yang dikerjakan oleh dosen dan juga mahasiswa dari desain interior tahun 2020. Selanjutnya furniture yang dibikin oleh Dede Avian Surya. Ini mahasiswa Postgraduate School ISI Yogyakarta yang membikin furniture dari kertas koran ya. Kalau kertas koran biasanya sudah dipakai untuk beberapa perabot ya, tapi bukan furniture. Nah, ini dia mencoba membuat furniture dari koran. Jadi keinginannya dia atau ungkapannya dia, kayu kanggo kertas, tapi opo kertas iso dadi kayu? Itu pertanyaannya dia, pertanyaan penciptaannya ya. Jadi dia kertas itu kan dibikin dari kayu, tapi sekarang bisa enggak dibalik? Jadi dia recycling, upcycle ya, dari sampah kertas kemudian dibikin menjadi bahan untuk furniture. Nah, ini dia melakukan eksperimen bagaimana kertas ini ditata per lembar, kemudian diberi glue dan kemudian dipres, setelah dipres dijemur, kemudian juga sedikit dipanasi dengan api, baru kemudian dibikin menjadi elemen-elemen dari furniture ya. Ini jadi lembarannya ya selebar kertas itu. Tapi sekarang koran nggak ada ya, semua online. Nah, itu yang jadi masalah. Tapi nggak apa-apa, ini ada ide yang menjadi masalah kemarin dan sudah dicoba dipecahkan. Ini adalah furniture yang dia desain. Jadi ini bahan, ini adalah lembaran kertas koran yang sudah dipres ya. Jadi ada tebalnya sama, hampir sama dengan apa multiplex ya, 1,8 atau 2 cm. Kemudian dipotong-potong menjadi bagian dari furniture tersebut. Ini tugas TA-nya di pasca sarjana. Ini beberapa desain yang lain ya. Dari tadi papan berbahan kertas koran. Kemudian kita masuk pada contoh ketiga, yaitu bendungan Lepen Gajah Wong. Kalau yang tinggal di Jogja pasti pernah ke sini ya. Nah, ini adalah salah satu contoh desain that amplify the grassroots effort ya. Jadi ini mungkin nggak ada desainernya di sini, tapi masyarakat itu sendiri yang jadi desainer ya. Nah, itu akan terjadi nantinya. Karena bisa jadi desainer terlalu mahal atau tidak ada desainer di situ. Bisa jadi sekarang masyarakat juga akan bisa mendesain sendiri ya. Jadi tadi desain satu sisi bisa desainer bisa masuk kemana-mana, tapi sekarang banyak orang juga bisa jadi desainer. Nah, ini active citizen ya. Biasanya untuk masyarakat-masyarakat seperti ini, citizen-nya juga aktif. Citizen-nya apa, ingin berkembang gitu, apa, memperbaiki diri mereka, memperbaiki lingkungan mereka. Ini adalah contoh bagaimana sebelumnya mereka itu concern terhadap ini ya, apa, garbage ya, apa, garbage, sampah yang ada di sungai. Oleh karena itu mereka mulainya dari membersihkan sungai dari sampah-sampah, ya, memasang jaring, apa ya, bekerja membersihkan selokan, ya, kebetulan sungainya ada di sebelah sini ya, mungkin di sebelah tadi ya. Nah, ini sungainya, kemudian di sebelah sininya itu adalah, kalau memundurkan gimana nih ya? Nih. Nah, ini selokannya. Jadi yang dibersihkan selokan. Dia tidak membersihkan sungainya sih ada ya sedikit, tapi yang difokuskan adalah membersihkan selokan yang ada di permukiman ini. Setelah bersih kemudian dikasih ikan-ikan ini. Ya. Nah, ternyata dengan seperti ini mengundang masyarakat lain untuk datang. Banyak yang piknik ke situ ya, bawa anak-anak, bawa keluarganya. Nah, kemudian apa, tumbuhlah ekonomi di situ, masyarakat bisa mencari uang dengan berjualan makanan ikan atau berjualan makanan yang dimakan oleh para wisatawan yang datang ke situ. Jadi di sini selain memperbaiki lingkungannya, memperindah, kemudian juga memperbaiki ekonominya karena banyak masyarakat yang bisa mencari uang di sini, mendapatkan uang. Juga tadi ada perubahan perilaku ya. Kalau tadinya kan masyarakat pinggir sungai itu kadang masyarakat ledok ya, biasanya kalau orang Jogja menyebut ledok itu ya terbiasa hidup seadanya gitu ya. Mereka tidak melihat kebersihan, tidak melihat pada membuang sampah pada tempatnya dan sebagainya. Tapi dengan adanya proyek ini, kemudian masyarakat menjadi terbiasa membuang sampah pada tempatnya. Kemudian di sini juga ada kejujuran ya, membangun kejujuran. Karena apa? Kalau misalnya beli makanan ikan itu kita bayar. Ada tempat gitu untuk naruh uang. Kalau kembali juga berapa itu ditaruh situ aja. Jadi ada belajar kejujuran, ada belajar servis ya, memberi pelayanan kepada para pendatang gitu ya. Jadi di satu sisi ini tidak hanya semata-mata memperbaiki lingkungan, tapi di situ ada perbaikan-perbaikan yang lain. Ya, serving habit, maintaining cleanliness, kemudian security, honesty, itu juga terbangun. Nah, itu adalah tiga desain yang coba saya tunjukkan kepada Anda bagaimana new ways of designing itu. Tentu masih ada banyak yang lain, seperti misalnya memulai dari context-based atau lingkungan yang ada, seperti misalnya wisata yang ada di di Imogiri itu dikelola juga oleh masyarakat. Nah, itu adalah contoh bagaimana potensi lingkungan kemudian diangkat menjadi sebuah karya yang bermanfaat untuk masyarakat ya. Tentu itu kemudian environment-nya terpelihara, masyarakat bisa cari uang, kemudian juga masyarakat di luarnya bisa berwisata ke situ, sehingga ada banyak manfaatnya ya. Nah, desainer perlu berpikir ke sana, karena tidak tadi problem lingkungan itu banyak dan kita harus mulai dari banyak sisi gitu. Nah, kemudian apa yang bisa kita lakukan? Nah, ini apa yang akan saya sampaikan di sini itu adalah tentang local wisdom ya. Jadi tadi untuk transition design tadi, selain berpikir futuristik, ternyata local wisdom itu juga punya potensi, bahkan potensi yang sangat besar untuk dipakai sebagai cara mengatasi problem lingkungan. Nah, selama ini local wisdom itu dipahami sebagai pengetahuan lokal saja atau kebijak apa sih kearifan ya. Misalnya etika lokal ya. Tapi sebetulnya local wisdom itu bisa lebih luas gitu. Nah, dan bahkan di barat juga sudah berlaku lokalism ya, pemikiran yang basisnya lokalism, berbasis lokal. Ini sebagai bagian dari globalism. Kalau di satu sisi globalism itu berpikir mendunia, nah kalau lokalism itu berpikir ke dalam. Tapi memang yang terbaik adalah gabungan dari lokalism dan globalism. Di satu sisi kita memikirkan lokal kita, tapi di sisi lain ini juga untuk global. Bagaimana kita bisa bergaul secara internasional. Kalau di sana disebut bukan global, tapi kalau kota itu apa namanya? Satunya urban. Aduh lupa, nggak tak tulis ya di sini. Bukan pulular sih. Sebentar ya, tak lihatnya. Yang kota-kota gitu loh. Bukan sih. Maksudnya kalau kebudayaan Islam tuh banyak mengandalkan kota itu apa? Ya masuk di kota, bukan kebudayaan desa. Sehingga di situ masyarakatnya terbuka, di situ masyarakatnya bukan madani sih, lupa nanti ya. Tapi intinya adalah globalism and localism. Nah, saya mau masuk kenapa localism itu perlu gitu ya. Kenapa kita perlu mengadopsi localism. Jadi localisme itu ada local knowledge, ada local value, ya local knowledge itu pengetahuan lokal. Misalnya bikin jamu Jawa itu ya, itu localism. Bikin rendang itu juga localism. Bikin apa ya? Banyak pengetahuan lokal yang ini Pranoto Mongso itu ya, tahu musim panas, musim hujan, musim rendang itu adalah local knowledge. Kemudian ada local value, ya nilai-nilai lokal, ya etika tadi, sopan santun dan sebagainya ya. Kemudian juga ada local skill, keterampilan lokal atau teknologi lokal. Tadi di bendungan tadi banyak memakai teknologi lokal. Demikian juga Dede itu memakai teknologi lokal. Kemudian ada local resources, itu ya local resources itu sebetulnya material-material lokal gitu ya, bambu, kayu pule, kayu jati dan sebagainya. Itu adalah hal-hal lokal yang bisa kita pakai. Kemudian juga local decision making ya. Jadi di sini ada cara berorganisasi yang bersifat lokal ya. Misalnya gotong royong atau mengambil keputusan secara musyawarah dan mufakat, itu adalah nilai-nilai lokal. Nah, ini desainer juga perlu tahu ini. Karena apa? Karena Anda nanti akan terlibat di masyarakat decision making-nya, mekanismenya itu sangat lokal. Mungkin di Bali itu karena ada Subak gitu ya, itu punya local decision making yang kuat gitu ya. Demikian juga di Jawa sini, di Sumatera, apalagi di Sumatera Barat, kemudian Sumatera Utara, Aceh. Mereka biasanya culture yang kuat itu punya mekanisme pengambilan decision atau cara berorganisasi di dalam masyarakat yang sangat lokal ya, sangat tertanam. Kemudian local solidarity group ini ya, misalnya ini tadi gotong royong dan sebagainya ya, menyumbang tetangga yang sedang mendapat musibah, itu adalah local solidarity dari sebuah masyarakat. Nah, ini adalah 6 jenis local wisdom. Jadi ada pengetahuan, ada etik, ada value, ada teknologi, kemudian ada bahan resources, dan ada local decision making dan local solidarity. Itulah 6 hal lokal yang perlu kita pelihara, perlu kita pelajari, perlu kita manfaatkan ketika Anda mau mendesain. Dan selanjutnya ini adalah why we need to adopt local wisdom. Local wisdom comes from the local community culture and it is in the social system of the community. Yeah. Local wisdom was born and grew with the community and its natural environment. Jadi dia pasti tertanam. Local wisdom is close, familiar, and blended with the community and its natural environment. Oleh karena itu, kemudian kenapa natural wisdom menjadi lebih mudah, ya, lebih suitable untuk dipakai di dalam menangani masalah lingkungan. Ya, masalah lingkungan itu tadi memang borderless, tapi dalam satu tempat-tempat tertentu, mereka sangat lokal, sangat tergantung tempat itu gitu loh. Ya, jadi bisa jadi jenis flood flashnya, jenis banjir bandangnya tuh beda antara yang di Eropa sana dengan yang di Indonesia atau di daerah tropik. Karena memang tadi dia sangat terikat dengan geografi. Oleh karena itu dalam pandangan saya, lokalisme itu sangat cocok atau sangat suitable untuk dipakai mengatasi masalah-masalah lingkungan. Demikian mungkin kuliah saya hari ini. Terima kasih kurang lebihnya. Mohon maaf. Thank you.
Okay, baik. English or Indonesia?
Okay.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Swastiwi. Master of Design for the lectures and deliver the material. So I would like to, of course, I would like to invite, saya mau mengundang, terutama teman-teman yang ada di sini, especially the participant here, the audience who would like to ask any question directly, mau langsung. You can question in any languages. Saket Indonesia, Jawa saket, Indonesia boleh. Or in English.
Atau sudah lapar.
Yeah. Yeah. Of course. Thank you. For the lectures. Dr. Swasti, I couldn't agree more because with the lectures since
Okay, bahasa Inggris juga.
Yeah, bahasa Inggris boleh ya. We realize we know that everybody is creative. Even those who doesn't have or don't have design background, so the community, they're also creative people, but sometimes they have difficulties to express their opinion maybe and their creativity until maybe they find a tool or something that's suitable for them to express and creating something that useful for the community. In your experience, so in that terms, in that perspective, how do you think the role of designers in the future will Okay. Since now the community can be the designer, so how is the role of us? I mean, the people who have design background in the future, maybe that can be.
So. Yeah. Thank you very much for the question. Actually, designer could become three roles, yeah, as the facilitator, as the generator, and also as the developer. So you can choose each of these. Facilitator, I will suggest if you work with the society, so you can become the facilitator. So, actually, you open up their idea, you open up their ability to express or to work more in that area. So it is more to facilitate these people. But when you work with the industry or with the people who have the same level or the same background, so you can become the generator or the developer. So maybe there are the idea of other people, other expert, so you develop this idea. And when nobody give the idea, so you can give, you can generate idea from the discussion and so on. That's what I suggest to the student, of course.
Yes, thank you. I also, of course, I agree with that statement. And there are some experts, yeah, that also believe in the future, also designer can be the one who create tools, who make the tools that allow participants or people or the society to create, to express their creativity. Actually, we witnessed this kind of activities lately. I mean that with the advance of the technology that allow people who don't have the ability to express, design. Yeah, or design, they can make creative stuff, maybe from the internet. Like we know that there are several tools that allow people to become creative, like maybe Canva. Yeah, that's now. We have seen. Yeah, we witnessed a lot of development in the tool. Yeah, tools that make it easier for people to express themselves. And express their creativity.
Maybe I can add something on the social design. Yeah, actually, in the social design, what the designer do is making tools. Yeah, making tools, rules, and a role. So when you design like protocol kesehatan, you give rules, you give tools, but not roles. Yeah, role is not many roles there. But when you design rumah sakit untuk misalnya orang sakit jiwa, di situ akan banyak sekali tools, rule, dan role. Jadi role, ada role dokter, ada role perawat, ada role yang harus menyuapi dan sebagainya gitu ya. Jadi kalau social design itu menciptakan tiga hal ini atau memikirkan ya, tidak menciptakan, memikirkan tiga hal. Rule, role, tools. Ya, jadi alat, rule itu adalah pedoman dan roles itu adalah peran ya. Siapa berperan, peran-peran apa saja di situ, rule apa saja yang harus dikerjakan, dan tools apa yang harus ada. Itu sederhananya seperti itu. Tapi tentu itu desain, social design itu sebuah hal yang complicated ya. Tidak bisa begitu saja di desain. Oke, okay, itu.
Ya, yeah. Please, versus Ifada.
Ya, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Cahyono, and thank you for Bu Swastiwi for the insightful lecture. My question is, I believe that nowadays society people associated design as something, or designer profession as someone who are expert in something that related to aesthetic and visually. My question is how to make society know that we designer can do more than that. I mean, we can solve that social problem that related to the social, because I believe that many people don't know that we can do that. That's my first question. And the second one is, design for social change. I think I believe it would be our future as well. But how the university provide those skills to students, which are, for example, we are interior designer, should we also learn about how to lead the community? How, yes, we are all, we of course we will work with any other expert for any other fields. But we have to have the skills to lead, to work with the society, to work with other people. How the university would provide those skills to the curriculum? That's my question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Ibu Ifada, for the question. Actually, it is something new. I will answer the second question first. Something new will happen in the future. So not only the designer, not only the society, actually the institution, the Lembaga Pendidikan Tinggi Design, should think how or what kind of knowledge, what kind of ability, what kind of skill they should talk about. Here in Carnegie Mellon, they already think how to educate students in their university about the transition design. So they, on the graduate level, they still have the communication, the product, and also the environment design. But after that, when they study the second layer, the master or the specialist, and also then the doctor, the specialist too, they should divide in more various focus of study, because it is also interdisciplinary. So design itself could not afford that by itself. So should ask the people from other department, whether it is psychology, whether it is engineering, or whether it is social science, to teach this design people. But we should start to think about that right now, because otherwise we will be left behind. We will be we will have difficulty in catching the next problem in the future. That's the second answer. And the one about the that people or the society still look at us because of the ability to give aesthetic or to give a decorative aspect of the, I think it's not the, we could not blame the society, but we should promote ourselves, yeah, especially the young designer, yeah, you should promote yourself to present that your design is not only about aesthetic. Your design is about how to live better, how to live in a more better condition. Yeah, not only better in, it means that it is mahal dan sebagainya, tapi bagaimana Anda memperlihatkan desain Anda itu punya ide, punya konsep, punya pemikiran yang lebih jauh, yang lebih canggih, tidak sekedar keindahan saja, tapi Anda betul-betul memecahkan masalah sampah plastik misalnya, atau masalah hemat energi misalnya, atau masalah hal yang lain. Saya pikir itu ya, we should promote ourselves with our works to show that it is not only the aesthetic, it is about how we live in a good condition, good design. Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the response. And we already have some questions in the chat. It's written in Indonesia, so I don't understand what it is. Shall I translate it into English? No?
Yeah.
Selamat siang, means good afternoon.
Menjadi salah satu inspirasi designing untuk kelanjutan sendiri. Mana yang banyak kita pelajari dari masyarakat rural. Namun realitanya justru masyarakat rural menjadi seringkali menjadi yang tidak teredukasi akan keberlanjutan sedang dikembangkan oleh pemerintah atau aktivis sekarang ini. Artinya sebuah kontradiksi. Menurut Ibu, bagaimana dengan kasus seperti ini? Ya, sebetulnya masalah silau terhadap kemajuan gitu ya. Ini kan banyak atau bahkan kita sendiri itu
kadang-kadang kita sendiri masih silau terhadap kemajuan ya, terhadap sesuatu yang datang dari barat itu sangat lumrah ya. Tapi kembali lagi kita harus memang tidak henti-hentinya mempopulerkan, tidak henti-hentinya menyampaikan bahwa hal-hal yang lokal itu belum tentu jelek. Hal-hal yang lokal itu justru banyak manfaatnya ke depan. Nah, itu perlu kita kumandangkan terus-menerus, kita populerkan, kita kampanyekan ya. Bahkan di sini saya sebetulnya punya usul untuk bagaimana ekoliterasi itu menjadi mata kuliah yang wajib diambil oleh mahasiswa. Ekoliterasi. Jadi melek huruf ya. Literasi itu apa? Literasi udah paham ya. Artinya Anda tuh paham dengan masalah lingkungan. Paham dengan masalah-masalah yang ada di situ sehingga Anda ketika mendesain juga sadar tentang hal itu. Karena seringkali desainer itu adalah orang yang dipesan oleh industri, orang yang dipesenin oleh klien, orang yang dipesenin oleh user masyarakat ya. Nah, sekarang ini karena problemnya sudah tidak bisa dihindari lagi, tidak bisa di kita tidak bisa melupakan itu, kita harus betul-betul mengatasinya. Oleh karena itu Anda perlu sadar, perlu literasi tadi. Ekoliterasi. Kalau sekarang ini di desain interior ada mata kuliah lingkungan hidup ya, tapi itu pilihan. Kalau saya itu enggak cukup. Harus itu justru menjadi mata kuliah wajib di semua departemen. Ekoliterasi. Karena semua orang harus terlibat, ini enggak bisa tidak dalam mengatasi masalah lingkungan. Demikian. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, saya juga mungkin apa jadi bahasa di saya. Ya. Yeah. I couldn't agree more, of course. I agree with that statement. And I have a vision that probably in the future that this concept, or not concept, the ideology of the environmental sustainability. It should be embedded in each subjects. So not maybe not dependently as one subject, but embedded to its subjects in the different subjects. In different subjects. Okay. Right. Maybe we can go through the. The other question, ya. Selamat siang, izin bertanya dari Faris Nur Afifah di atasnya, Bu.
Kalau saya perhatikan, sustainability erat kaitannya dengan konservasi sebuah kawasan. Yang menjadi pertanyaan adalah mengapa dua mata kuliah ini dipisahkan? Apakah ada batasan antara kedua mata? Ini konservasi dan sustainability.
Oke, terima kasih untuk pertanyaannya dari Nur Afifa ya. Kalau konservasi memang lebih terbatas daripada sustainability ya. Konservasi lebih bagaimana memperbaiki yang sudah rusak ya, to conserve. Sementara kalau sustainability biasanya berpikir secara lebih luas. Jadi bisa jadi sumber daya yang dipunyai belum mencukupi untuk memberikan tadi ilmu tentang sustainability, design sustainable gitu ya. Karena itu tadi seperti tadi saya sampaikan, sustainable design itu sangat luas cakupannya, sementara untuk konservasi itu memang lebih terbatas sehingga dia lebih pada memperbaiki yang apa yang sudah kita punya dan itu menunjukkan degradasi atau menurun kualitasnya sehingga perlu dikonserv, baik itu lingkungan ataupun bisa benda-benda karya seni ataupun karya yang monumental. Jadi seperti itu kenapa dipisahkan ya. Sebetulnya konservasi bagian dari sustainability, tapi karena sustainability mungkin belum punya cukup sumber daya untuk memberikan sustainability sehingga diberikan dulu yang konservasi. Tapi ke depan memang harus ada ilmu atau tadi literasi untuk ekologi ya. Tentu memang terbatas ya. Nah, harapannya masing-masing mahasiswa atau masing-masing orang, masing-masing ahli itu mengembangkan bidang-bidang yang kecil-kecil tadi ya. Karena tidak mungkin dicakup semuanya dalam satu orang ataupun satu bagian gitu. Kita perlu dukungan banyak pihak. Demikian mungkin ya jawabannya. Terima kasih.
Oke. Okay. Right. I would like to invite for participants and audience here to throw more question. Or maybe you can start a discussion. You can write down on the chat, or you can ask directly here. Okay. Yeah. If we have if we have to change, make a big change, we need to involve a bigger audience and even those who have the power to make the change, like a government and intergovernment. It's a huge effort to do that, and we don't always have access to do that. But we witnessed in the past that this kind of movement, they really can have they can influence people to make a change, even though that it's not always a direct response. For example, like throwing the garbage everywhere. Yeah, I mean, but it's like gradually people know that they're not supposed to throw rubbish or garbage to the river. So, but it's some people still do that, of course. We witnessed that it's something that's become like a haram. You can't do that. You can't throw the rubbish to the into the river. And for the ozone, the ozone layer also, we in 2016 or 17, I think the scientists, they report that there's an improvement in the condition of the ozone layer on our Earth. So it's not something that's happen in instant, but it's gradually this movement that make change, that to avoid the use of CFC, the dangerous CFC, it make an improvement in condition for the condition of the ozone layer. Yeah, sometimes we don't think about it, sometimes we don't care, but when the government and those who have power, they put this restriction, they have the rules to make the industry to not to use that bad habit, I mean, to use the CFC. It's still something that we have to use in the future. Right. Okay. Let's move to, we have more question here. Okay. From Suwarna Wisetrotomo. Selamat siang, Dr. Swasti. Silakan dibaca, Bu. Yes. Yeah, thank you for the presentation. In terms of dramatic climate change, are designers capable of being changers? Yeah, in the middle of various interests in the name of development.
Thank you, Pak Suwarno Wisetrotomo, for the question. How should designer education be directed in the future or tomorrow? what I already said before, that we need an eco-literacy. That is very necessary for the people who work for creating the world, whether it is designer, it is engineer, or it is artist, who create works for the world, for the man-made world, they should have that. The knowledge about our environment, it is very, 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 what is it? Sangat mendesak, sangat, very crucial and very in critical or strong suggestion for that people to have that kind of knowledge, because they create the word. So if they don't have the knowledge about what happened right now in the world, that is very, a pity. Yeah, that is sangat sangat berbahaya, sangat sangat kasihan dan sangat berbahaya bagi dunia kita. Karena tanpa stubborn aja kita itu sudah sulit dirubah untuk berubah menjadi lebih sustainable. Karena apa? Karena yang sekarang kita nikmati itu adalah sebuah kenikmatan, adalah sebuah kenyamanan yang kalau disuruh pergi dari kenyamanan itu sulit sekali. Padahal kenyamanan ini biayanya mahal, biayanya sangat sangat tinggi bagi lingkungan hidup kita. Seperti saya katakan dalam teks tadi, saat ini itu kita sudah memakai resources bumi 1,6 dari yang bisa disediakan oleh bumi untuk sustainable ya. Jadi kita tuh sudah lebih 0,6. Jadi kalau jatahnya harusnya 1, itu kita sudah mengambil 1,6. Nah, nanti yang nanggung berikutnya siapa? Anak cucu kita. Bukan kita lagi, mungkin kita sudah wassalam ya, sudah di mana gitu. Tapi anak cucu kita yang akan merasakan drought, yang akan merasakan forest fire, kemudian flood, bahkan juga banjir bandang dan sebagainya. Nah, itu semua yang sering tidak disadari. Oleh karena itu kampanye ataupun apa ya. Ini kita sekarang di kelas atau di ruangan ini sadar gitu ya, tapi begitu keluar, begitu kita menikmati hal-hal yang menyamanan kita akan lupa. Nah, itu sulitnya memang ada di situ, bagaimana merubah mindset, bahkan merubah culture ya, tidak mindset saja, tapi culture kita. Begitu Pak Wisetrotomo, education tentu harus berubah, karena education itu adalah menyiapkan masa hidup yang lebih baik. Nah, kalau kita tidak berubah ya, nah ini memang kewajiban dari kita semua untuk segera memikirkan bagaimana sebaiknya pendidikan tidak hanya desain ya, tapi juga seni pada umumnya ataupun orang-orang yang bergerak pada dunia pendidikan, untuk orang-orang yang bergerak pada penciptaan dunia buatan manusia. Demikian mungkin jawaban saya untuk Pak Suwarno. Kemudian ada pertanyaan lagi ya?
There's another question, ya. Yeah. Maybe the last question.
Mbak Nabila, saya ingin bertanya, promote ourselves to society. Bagaimana cara kami sebagai mahasiswa untuk memulai promote ourselves to society? Bahwa desain bukan hanya tentang estetik, but we can make the good design. Kemudian hal terkecil apa yang bisa dilakukan oleh mahasiswa untuk andil dalam pembangunan lingkungan di masyarakat selagi? Ya, tentunya dengan sebetulnya sekarang Anda punya alat yang demikian canggih ya, namanya sosial media ya. Nah, itu Anda harus manfaatkan untuk promote yourself ya, promote your design, not only the selfie, not only your body, but your thought, your thinking, the works ya, so that maybe start with your friends, but after that, if your content could persuade, could make into a viral move, so that everybody could be could be persuade or could be dipengaruhi ya. Nah, Anda punya hal yang sangat bagus ya. Nah, untuk saya, untuk generasi saya, sosial media itu masalah apa? Karena udah nggak bisa mengikuti nunak-nunu, tahu nggak nunak-nunu? Kalau nanti kalau keblasuk itu wah, mau pulang gitu bingung dulu. Udah itu punya Anda, punya sosial media itu punya Anda dan Anda bisa memanfaatkannya. Orang bikin konten bisa dapat berapa miliar satu bulan. Anda bikin konten yang jos, yang lain gitu ya, untuk bisa mempengaruhi masyarakat. Itu mungkin ya jawabannya.
Oke, okay. Thank you for your response, Dr. Swastiwi. Oke, okay, that's if there's no other questions coming or discussion, I think that will be our last question for today. And okay, due to the time limit, I'm afraid I need to finish our discussion, lecture and discussion today. And of course, I would like to send our biggest gratitude to Dr. Swastiwi. I would like to invite the participant to send the biggest applause for the day. Thank you, and thank you for the audience here as well, and the participants online. This will be the final for today. I would like to close the second session, and I'm going to revoke my duty as moderator and back to the Master of Ceremony.
Thank you, Mr. Octavianus. Fascinating topic about sustainability and how design can partake in it. Thank you, Dr. Swastiwi MDes. Thank you, Mr. Octavianus. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of the lecture for today. Tomorrow, we will have three lecture sessions. Dr. Alfie Luviani, MFA, presenting In a Tumultuous World, Art Matter at 8:30. Hazel Lim, MFA, presenting Color Indicted at 10 o'clock, followed by Mumtaz Mokhtar, PhD, presenting Art for Society 5.0 at 11:30. We will see you tomorrow. Good afternoon. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Untuk menyaksikan metafor-metafor baru, ide baru, konsep baru yang saya yakin memiliki banyak kejutan dan aspek novelty yang kita butuhkan untuk membangkitkan ide-ide kita sendiri. Acara keseluruhan akan diselenggarakan di gedung Ajijasa Fakultas Seni Rupa ISI Yogyakarta. Pamerannya diselenggarakan secara luring dan secara daring. Kuliah dari dosen tamu juga di sana. Lihat, perhatikan, ambil hikmahnya. Bagaimana mereka menghadirkan merepresentasi yang non benda itu menjadi karya gelaran kreatif.